So I'm Dr. Chintan Desai, and I'm part of the Advanced Orthopedics team, where, and I deal with the shoulders. So just trying to figure this out. So I'm going to be talking today about imaging and shoulder instability, mainly shoulder MRIs and a little bit about CT scans, because that's important to cover everything in instability. We are going to cover some basic views, something about slap injuries or slap tears. We're going to cover about the anterior and posterior labrum and glenoid bone loss and Hill Sachs lesions. So let's begin. So let's dwell upon some basic anatomy of the shoulder. And here we see, we all know that the humeral head, the scapula, the glenoid, the acromion, and the clavicle form the shoulder. However, today we are going to concentrate more upon the glenoid structures and a part of the humeral head as well, which is involved in instability imaging. Following which, there is the capsule. This is kind of like a soft tissue which covers or bridges the gap between the glenoid or, and the humeral head. The long head of the biceps here, which goes right in and attaches to the superior part of the labrum, which forms. So, if somebody has a slap injury, the tear would be somewhere super in the superior quadrant over here. And the labrum, which covers the shoulder all the way around. Today, we are going to discuss a lot more in detail about the labral injuries because that's what we are looking for in shoulder instability. Then, of course, the rotator cuff muscles, the subscapularis, the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. We are not going to be discussing about the rotator cuff in this talk today. So, how do you position a patient with a shoulder MRI? The shoulder instability MRIs are basically performed in two positions. One is a standard position in which the arm is to the side, but then there is a special position called as an ABER view, which means abduction external rotation. So this view is important when you are really suspicious about instability of the shoulder and you want to get things ruled out, like minor injuries. Please remember that in the shoulder, it is inclined to the body, so you need to position the coils accordingly. So all the shoulder images are taken in the plane of the supraspinatus or in the plane of the scapula, and that's when you're going to get the correct images. Mithen has quite in detail dwelt upon the imaging at about the types of images, the T1, T2 weighted, the STIR, and the fat suppressed images. The same holds true for the shoulder, so we can see the same images. And we are basically now dealing with three images of the shoulder, or three views, which is the axial, the coronal, and the sagittal. So how do we really say what is the sagittal, what is the coronal, what's the axial? It's quite simple. It's mainly the terminology is given as the sutures of the head. So the sagittal suture, which is straight here, the coronal suture is like this, and the axial images take cuts at perpendicular sections to the body. So in the shoulder, the coronal images are quite important. So when you see the shoulder like this in the line of the supraspinatus, you will see the coronal images like so. And these are important to check more so of the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, or the rotator cuff injuries. These are also very important to locate slap injuries. The axial images are more so important to look more at the end face of the glenoid. You will be able to appreciate if there is any bony edema or an injury of the bone of the glenoid here. And you can see very well the pear shape of the glenoid here. This is not so much important to look at the labrum, although yes, you will be able to see the labrum, but very difficult to really appreciate labral injuries there. It helps us also look at or locate Hill Sachs tears, Hill Sachs lesions, mainly which are depressed injuries of the humeral head here. And axial images are very important for today's talk, and axial cuts are very important for today's talk, as these axial cuts help us locate mainly the labrum, the anterior, the posterior labrum, and we need to look or concentrate on these images here. So on the axial T1 weighted images are quite helpful and important because the ligaments or the labral structures look quite dark and nice. The bone appears white and there is a good contrast. We can also appreciate the cartilage there. And these then become important. So T1 weighted images in the axial view help us locate much better the labrum. So are you able, so everyone, is everyone able to see this share screen again?
Yes, we are able to see it.
Yes, we are seeing.
So now we go on to looking at what a slap tear. Slap is nothing but a superior labrum tear in the anterior and posterior dimension. And it is where the biceps anchor attaches to the labrum or the glenoid. The slap tears can be categorized mainly into, there are two classifications. The first one is classified as four tears like this. The first one is just degeneration or wear and tear or somewhat like a mucoid degeneration as Mithane pointed out in the ACL. A little bit of fraying is seen on the MRI. So fraying of the superior labrum is a type 1 slap injury. If this persists or becomes chronic or somebody has a severe enough injury, they can develop a type 2, which is from 11 o'clock. So since the glenoid is round, it is the imaging, when you see the report, the tear of the labrum is like, is said like a clock. So 12 o'clock is this one. The 6 o'clock is the bottom, 9 is here and 3 is here. So a tear of the superior labrum from 11 o'clock to the 2 o'clock position is a type 2 superior labrum tear, which is a slap tear. Type 3 is a bucket handle tear where the superior labrum is completely torn and looks like a handle, kind of. It is interned into the joint. And a type 4 in which it is not only a bucket handle tear, but the tear also goes into the biceps tendon itself. Type 5 tears are also classified in which not only it's like a type 2 tear, but the tear extends to the anterior and inferior labrum. So the entire superior and anterior inferior labrum are torn. And a type 6 tear is like a type 4 in which there is a bucket handle injury, but there is a transection of the biceps tendon. So when you look at the MRI images, a coronal image of the MRI will help you to locate slap injuries very easily and better. And when you see slight amount of edema at the top over there, these are patients who have injuries either in the throwing position or have fallen on the extended arm, or they are moving, like trying to catch a train and the train is moving and the arm gets pulled or jerked. That's when you kind of get a slap injury. So a type 1 slap, where you don't see any discontinuity but a little bit of edema and fraying over there, that's a type 1 slap. A type 2 slap, you see, you need 3 or 4 images to cover the superior labrum and you'll be able to see this type of a joint fluid percolating underneath the superior labrum in 2 or 3 sections of the coronal scan, and that's when you can say there's a type 2 slap. The type 3, as you see, the joint fluid is percolating not only here, but also on top, kind of saying that, this labrum is interning into the joint and can be labeled as a bucket handle tear. And a type 4 where you see injury going also into the biceps tendon. So concentrate on the coronal images when a patient has an injury like this, not only to see the supraspinatus, but also to locate slap tears. An interesting thing, just day ago. So yesterday I had a patient who is a golfer and also likes to play polo. And he has this movement, which he continuously has to do, not only in polo, but also in golf. So So he has this pain in his shoulder going on for the last 6 years. He says that, you know, my power is reduced and I'm unable to play my whole golf swing. And when you look at these patients' MRI, it is extremely important when they say that my stroke is affected, that you need to look for those slap injuries. And he had a slap injury. I'm about to operate that patient soon. Anyway, so now when you look at a labrum tears or the anterior and inferior labrum injuries, or anterior and posterior labral tears, what you're looking for is a detachment of the labrum from the anterior part of the glenoid. And a complete detachment, what you see here is, this is the scapular periosteum. This is a continuation of the capsular ligament. So hence, you know, when you read these reports, you will see a labroligamentous injury is what they would call this. So scapular periosteum leading on to the ligament, which could be the middle and the inferior glenohumeral ligaments, depending upon where you're taking the section, and the labrum. It can be a osseous lesion where there is a discontinuation, and this is called as a bony Bankart lesion. A reverse Bankart is nothing but a detachment of the labrum, labroligamentous complex posteriorly. A Perthes lesion is where the labrum is detached, but the scapular periosteum is intact. Okay. So to kind of put it simply, this is nothing but a Bankart tear in a Perthes lesion also doesn't allow and doesn't provide any stability to the joint. Okay. And you need to treat this, or we need to treat this just like a Bankart tear. An ALPSA lesion is an anterior labroligamentous periosteal sleeve avulsion, where you see that the scapular periosteum, which should be intact like this, the periosteum is avulsed and the labrum is kind of interned into the labrum, into the periosteum there, but the ligament is intact. Again, this is exactly like a shoulder instability. And the last but not the least is called as a GLAD lesion, where there is a cartilage detachment along with the labrum. Okay, so it's a glenolabral articular cartilage disruption. So fancy terms, but all of these basically are the same as a Bankart tear. Clinically, when you look at them, they are all unstable and they all need treatment to get that fixed for their instability to resolve. Now let's look at a few cases. So I'll stop sharing this and I'll share another screen. Yeah. So all these images, if you are interested, there is a fantastic the Stanford School of Medicine has just laid out their images for learning purposes, and if you're interested, these are fantastic cases that you can just go in and look. We often use this as a reference for some of our patients in which we are confused. So all these images are available on the link, and I'll be sharing this link with you. But you can go over these images. They have images of the knee, for the foot and ankle, for the spine, for the shoulder, for everything. So anyway, so now this is our first case where we are going to be looking at an anterior labral tear. So when you look at the axial images, you are trying to look from the top. So from the top, when you go to the bottom, you are now seeing the acromion. This is the clavicle. This is the AC joint. And when you go down, now you start seeing the coracoid process here. Okay. You start seeing the superior glenoid. This is the humeral head. And the labrum is starting to appear now. And now when you slowly slide down, now here you see there is a detachment of the labrum. And you can say that this is kind of like an early instability or possibly a first dislocation, but not very significant, because you're not very severe, I would say, or not very hugely traumatic, because you don't see a lot of edema in this region of the humeral head. Now, please imagine that when the humeral head dislocates anteriorly, this humeral head is kind of over here, and you will have an impact of the humeral head, the back of the humeral head, on the front of the glenoid, and then you develop a defect over here called as the Hill-Sachs defect. Okay, so this Hill-Sachs defect we need to treat, and we're going to see if we need to treat them or not. We need to calculate a few things, but on depends upon the depth of the hair sacs. So here you see a little bit of bony edema, and that's early development of the hair sacs defect. But you clearly see that the posterior labrum is quite intact. There is no fluid seepage, but the joint fluid is now seeping between the glenoid cartilage and the labrum here. So that's our anterior labrum tear. It goes and extends inferiorly. So when you go down, yeah. So this could be labeled as anterior-inferior labral tear or typical Bankart lesion extending downwards from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock position. So the first thing you see is fluid seepage underneath the cartilage. Then you see the anterior labral detachment. Then you will see the Hill Sachs impact fracture. And that's an anterior labral or Bankart, typical Bankart tear with a Hill Sachs lesion. Let's look at our next case. So again, the axial view for locating instability problems going down. Now here you see that there is significant amount of hemorrhage or bony edema, hemorrhage. So in the sense, fluid collection in the joint, which looks quite bright here. And you see the depth of the Hill Sachs over here is a little bit more pronounced. So it's a deeper Hill Sachs lesion. Now you see that quite pronounced over here. And this, as you see, there is a fluid seepage there. This periosteum looks intact, but the labrum is torn. So this is an anterior labral tear with an intact periosteum. Any guesses? What is this with an intact periosteum? That's a Perthes lesion, right? So the periosteum is intact, but the labrum is torn. That is a Perthes lesion for you. The next case. Again, a lot of edema in the joint going from the top to the bottom. From the top to the bottom. Now here you see that the Hill Sachs defect is quite deep. Yes. And then you go down and you don't see any labrum at all. Okay. In fact, it has displaced so much. And when you see a displacement like this, you can assume that, you know, you're going to have a larger Hill Sachs tear. Let's just go through the findings. Yeah, so there is no labrum attachment there at all. The whole mass has medialized. There is a large Hill Sachs lesion. And you could call this as an ulpsa tear. Okay. Our next case. Okay, so this is a posterior instability patient where you see that the anteriorly, this patient doesn't have too much of a anterior labrum defect, but here, as you see, fluid is seeping posteriorly. So the posterior labrum is intact. Now, how do you really make out whether what is anterior, what is posterior? Always look at the biceps. So you see this biceps is always going to be anterior, and and this is the posterior labrum, right? So that's a posterior labrum tear. Let's just confirm our findings. A reverse Bankart lesion, a reverse Hill Sachs lesion or a trough sign, and that's our posterior dislocation. Our last case. This is again.
Hello.
Yeah, and again a reverse Bankart tear. Perfect. So that's all about our shoulder instability MRIs. Now let's jump on to our ABER views. Now, when we get an ABER view, we are looking at a defect, or the patient keeps complaining of instability, but a regular MRI images does not give us a significant enough tear, that's when we kind of anticipate either it's an undisplaced fracture of the humor of the anterior glenoid, which is causing the patient instability, or it's an minimally displaced labrum, which is not appreciated. And when you put the patient's arm in this position of abduction and external rotation to kind of stretch the anterior labrum and the labral ligamentous complex, is when you see the anterior labrum opening up. And this opening up is well appreciated on an Eber view. So not all patients need an Eber view. It's only when, you know, the patient continues to complain of instability, but the regular MRI doesn't really show any significant images, is when you kind of need to force your radiologist to get a Eber view done. Now, this is quite a new concept here. This is called as an on and off track Hill-Sachs. So as we saw that the Hill-Sachs is a defect of the posterior humeral head when the shoulder dislocates anteriorly. So what you are seeing here is a patient who is doing an abduction and external rotation. So basically, how much of the posterior humeral head is being covered by the glenoid? So you see this pear shape of the glenoid, it is covering the posterior humeral head, and that is what is keeping the shoulder in alignment. So this is important when, as you saw, the deeper Hill-Sachs lesions, do we need to treat them or not, is dictated now by this concept of on and off track Hill-Sachs, which can be seen very well on 3D or calculated on 3D CT scans. And this this concept was brought ahead by this very famous professor from Japan, Professor E.G. Itoi. For those interested, you can go ahead and look at this paper. It's a very detailed discussion about this. Again, now as you see here, why is this important to calculate? A Hill-Sachs defect in a, this is a patient's arm in abduction external rotation like this on top, and this is the glenoid, right? So not when a patient dislocates the shoulder anteriorly, not only does he tear his anterior labrum, but he can develop a defect of the posterior humeral head, which is the Hill-Sachs. So here there is a tear of the anterior capsulo-ligamentous complex, and there is a Hill-Sachs lesion. But when the patient's arm is put or stressed in abduction external rotation, the Hill-Sachs is not engaging. What do you mean by engaging and non-engaging is whether this Hill-Sachs defect is getting trapped underneath the anterior labrum like this and gets locked. And that's when you have a locked anterior dislocation. So when the patient cannot, you know, or the doctor cannot manipulate it back in the joint, that's a locked anterior dislocation. And that locking happens because this Hill-Sachs lesion or Hill-Sachs defect is entrapped in this anterior glenoid. So we perform these tests under anesthesia and under arthroscopy to kind of tell us whether we need to fix this Hill-Sachs lesion or not. And this is what you see when the patient's arm is place in abduction external rotation and it is translated anteriorly, if this defect engages or not. Now, once you have repaired the anterior labrum, so we go ahead and we repair this, and then we find that it is now not engaging. So in which it is not, you know, engaging into the anterior glenoid rim, then we don't need to really fix this Hill-Sachs defect. There is a procedure called as a remplissage procedure, in which we fix the infraspinatus into this defect to kind of make the humeral head tighter, and so that it doesn't, there is a little bit of stiffness that we create so that it doesn't go into a lot of external rotation and preventing this Hill-Sachs from engaging. But when we find these patients where after repairing the anterior labral ligamentous complex and stressing them, if this Hill-Sachs is still engaging, that's when we need to fix this Hill-Sachs lesion. And the on and off track concept and engaging and non-engaging Hill-Sachs lesion is important to evaluate this. Now, although I've put this slide here, it's a complex calculation which you know, the radiologists learn to do. But mainly what we see is we have to do a CT scan of the normal side also, and where we then locate the total size of the glenoid. And then we locate how much of that is tracking. So what is the size that tracks in that area? And if it is smaller, so if the hill sacs is larger than the tracking, then obviously there is a little bit of a, there is either a bone loss of the glenoid or there is a very large hill sacs defect. And then we need to fix that. So we had now dealt with the hill sacs defect, which is the posterior glenoid bone entrapment, which happens. And this is another ball game altogether, which is glenoid bone loss. So where the anterior glenoid with recurrent dislocations kind of fades away or rubs away. It starts with either a glenoid fracture and then there is a resorption of the bone over there. And then this is quite important for us to locate. So what is the size of the glenoid, whether it is reduced or is, you know, the same. And then we need to see what percentage of bone loss has happened. So what you see here, the affected side 19 millimeters and the non-affected side 25 millimeters. So 6 millimeter bone loss has happened. And when you calculate the percentage, which is 6/25 × 100 is approximately 24%. And when this bone loss is more than 20% is when we need to do another procedure called, so in these patients, just fixing the anterior glenoid labrum may not be sufficient because of the glenoid tracking. And then these patients can persist, have recurrent dislocations even after Bankart repairs. So hence we need to do a special procedure called as a latter J, in which we excise the coracoid process and we bone graft the coracoid and fix it to the anterior glenoid labrum. So that is dictated by how much bone loss there is on the glenoid. And on an average, if it is about more than 20%, then we need to do that. So with that said, thank you for your patient listening. I hope this talk was helpful for you. There is, and I hope we have covered everything there is to cover about shoulder instability imaging. If there are any